mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
Good morning, I'm Mike Yoreta here. These stories that made it to AMC's Rundown. A member of the ruling PDP Laban Party claims that Davao City Mayor Sara Duterte Carpio is running for president in 2022. Philippine cinemas are set to reopen today after having been closed for nearly 2 years. And the Senate cuts the budget of the government's anti-communist task force to benefit the country's healthcare workers. Davao City Mayor Sara Duterte Carpio withdraws her re-election bid, raising speculation she may run for a national post in 2022. This as the first daughter has been topping presidential surveys. She has, however, repeatedly said in the past that she will not be seeking the country's top post. But this may change soon after she backed out of the mayoral race in Davao City. Her brother, Vice Mayor Sebastian Baste Duterte, will instead be running in her place.
Pero I guess kuha na lang yun. Kung unsa man eh, let's hope na lang na let's be positive na maayo unta ang outcome aning decision ni Mayor Inday na ma-withdraw ko. And something good might come out of it. In order for the both parties to function properly, I have to follow order. So that's why naisugo si Mayor Inday sa kuha. Mausunod ako para mo andar ang makinarya.
2022 vice presidential aspirant Senator Bongo also hints of a change of plans. Go, who is running under the ruling party, PDP Laban, gave an emotional speech about the future of his candidacy Tuesday, the same day that Davao City Mayor Sara Duterte Carpio dropped her mayoral bid.
Kandidatura ko bilang vice presidente ay maaring magbago. Ang problema about the substitution dito sa politika, maaring may magbabago sa mga tatakbuhang posisyon sa mga darating na araw. Ang problema po dyan, kailangan ko umiwas. Gustuhin ko mang magsilbi sa inyo bilang inyong vice presidente dahil sa kagustuhan ng ating mahal na Pangulo, kailangan ko pong umiwas. Malalaman nyo lang po yan sa darating na araw.
Go, a longtime aide of President Rodrigo Duterte, also talked about the chief executive's possible senatorial run.
As a senator, candidate 51-49. 51% running, 49% not running. So yan po ang aking personal assessment kung tatakbo si Pangulong Duterte.
All these political moves are pointing to a Bongbong Marcos-Sara Duterte tandem in 2022. That's according to some analysts. They believe the recent events and statements from Duterte's allies indicate that the presidential daughter will not be gunning for the country's top post, but as the vice presidential running mate of Ferdinand Marcos Jr.
Ang basa ko is as VP, I think. Kasi meron din developments na mga nakaraan, no? Yung sinabi ni Marcos Jr. noong mga nakaraang araw, he said na si Sara Duterte hindi natatakbo bilang presidente. But he did not really say whether Sara Duterte is going to run as vice president. Pangalawa, yung pag-withdraw po ni Mayor Sara, kaakibat naman yun yung statement ni Senator Bongo no? Na nagpapahiwatig na hindi, wala nang kasiguraduhan yung pagtakbo niya sa VP.
Even if you have the political capital and the wherewithal to run a strong campaign for the presidency, it is best to slide to the vice presidency and perhaps bide your time until you are strong enough. The best logical combination for both of them, because first and foremost, they've already had an informal alliance. The Dutertes and the Marcoses have had an informal alliance in 2016. And now is the time for them to formalize that alliance, since their politics are essentially the same. No? They both constitute what can be considered an anti-EDSA coalition.
As for the opposition, Professor Julio Tihanqui says that they must now go back to the drawing board to prepare for a possible Marcos-Duterte tandem.
Unfortunately, for the opposition, they are still caught in what is known as the prisoner's dilemma, that they believe that on their own, they can win. And the more they pursue their political self-interest, the more their votes will be divided, and the more they will not be able to combine their strength to mount a formidable challenge to the administration. And it's so easy to win if you have, all these votes scattered all over the place. No? So but consolidation is key.
But a member of the ruling PDP-Laban party claims that Duterte Carpio is running for the president in the 2022 elections. Albay Representative Joey Salceda says that the vice presidency is not an option for Duterte Carpio.
Definitely, that's our speculation. So because she's running for president. All this political gyration just shows that she's moving towards the presidency. I cannot say that confirming, but based on our long-running chats, kilometric chats, that she eyes her. Because I provided her with so many data analytics, big data, and everything about her prospects, and I think she would make a good president in the first place. She wanted to be president in the first place since May.
The Commission on Elections takes the first step towards resolving a disqualification case against presidential bet Bongbong Marcos. The petition filed by several civic groups last week has been raffled off to the COMELEC Second Division. Commissioners Socorro Inting and Antonio Claude Jr., who are both appointees of President Rodrigo Duterte, will be hearing the case. The petitioners hope that the COMELEC will resolve this case quickly, while the Marcos camp continues to dismiss the issue, even citing the dean of the University of Santo Tomas's Faculty of Law, Nilo Divina, who prescribed the petition as ad hominem or as an attack against Marcos's character. In other news, Davao City Mayor Sara Duterte Carpio fires her information officer for attending a party where drugs were seized by anti-narcotics agents. Jeffrey Tupas admitted that she was at the event, which was held at a resort in Davao de Oro, but she claims she left the party early. Anti-drug officers who raided that resort arrested 17 people, confiscating some 1.5 million pesos worth of party drugs and marijuana. The Philippine Drug Enforcement Agency says they will investigate claims that agents raiding that party allowed Tupas and others to leave.
From the very start of the operation, 17 na po yung ating arrested drug personality. So hindi natin alam how come nagkaroon ng ganyan. But of course, yun nga, as I've said earlier, there is a beach park, a lot of people there. Kasi yung sinasabi na whatever it is that they are saying, these are mere speculations they're making.
Duterte Carpio, whose father has waged a massive war against illegal drugs, has been trying to distance herself from this issue. Philippines reported 1,409 new COVID-19 cases Tuesday. This is the lowest single-day tally since mid-February. The number of active infections has fallen to 30,000, which is also the lowest it's been since February 28th. 48 new deaths and nearly 3,000 more recoveries were also reported. Philippine Health Secretary Francisco Duque III says Metro Manila may be downgraded to alert level 1 if the number of daily cases drops to 500 or even 1,000. This as Metro Manila is under alert level number 2 until the 21st of November.
Sino man naman na may ayaw na mas mababa ang ating alert level, eh mas malaking bahagi ng ekonomiya naman ang ating mabubuksan at mas marami rin tayong mababawing mga trabahong nawala. At ang sigla ng ekonomiya ay manumbalik at ang normal ay bumalik din sa buhay ng bawat Pilipino.
The Philippine Health Department recommends the voluntary use of face shields in areas under alert level 1. Health Secretary Francisco Duque III says this policy can also be implemented in areas under alert level 2, except for when inside public transportation. Duque's statement comes after some mayors went ahead and scrapped the face shield mandate in their respective cities without the consent of the national government.
Ay padadaanin muna sa IATF bago po namin sumite for your approval, Mr. President. So sa Thursday po, magkakaroon ng pagpupulong ang IATF.
Cinemas in the National Capital Region and in the nearby provinces will be reopening their doors to the public today for the first time since this pandemic began. They are, however, only open to fully vaccinated individuals. The Film Development Council of the Philippines is reminding moviegoers that face masks are required for the entire duration of each movie. Face shields, however, can be removed. And while drinking is allowed, eating is strictly prohibited. Moviegoers must also maintain their distances. Safety officers will be disinfecting the seats after every showing. Several mall chains all over Metro Manila are opening their movie houses today. Hollywood films Dune and A Quiet Place Part 2 will be shown in these cinemas. President Duterte says there is nothing illegal about companies refusing to hire those unvaccinated from COVID-19. He does, however, believe that it is illegal to fire unvaccinated workers. He says that by turning down unvaccinated applicants, employers are just trying to protect their businesses.
Kung nandiyan ka na sa trabaho mo at ayaw mong magpabakuna, well, that is too bad for the employer. The other problem is yung papasok kayo na you seek employment and then one of the reasons that would be asked of you by the prospective employer would be kung bakunado ka. Na kung sabihin mo hindi at whatever reason ibigay mo doon sa kanya, para ang importante lang naman sa kanya, bakunado ka hindi. Kung hindi ka bakunado, hindi ka tanggapin sa trabaho. I think that is legal. You have the right to refuse to accept as an employee of somebody who is not vaccinated.
The Philippine government's anti-communist task force will suffer a huge budget cut next year. That's according to the committee chairman of the Senate's Finance Committee, Sonny Angara. From the proposed 30.45 billion peso budget, the task force is now down to 4 billion pesos. Now, the reduction totaling 24 billion pesos will instead be given to the country's health sector. Angara says that the cut was made after the agency failed to fully report how they spent some 16 billion pesos to help local villages this year.
We cannot make a judgment really if the program has been a success or not, because we've not received any, very little information on the actual projects. Kasi ang sinasabi, dinownload na yung pondo. The DBM tells us, binigay na nila yung pondo sa mga barabarangay or the mga municipalities or provinces kasi nga LGU-based yan, no? Local government-based. And yun ang inaantay namin. Asa na yung mga reports on the projects? Wala na pala pang binibigay sa amin.
Other lawmakers are lauding the Senate panel's move. Senator Franklin Brilon says he fully supports this decision. Senator Panfilo Lacson is also in favor of slashing the agency's budget, stressing the need to punish all those who misuse this year's funds. Gabriela Party List Representative Arlene Brosas is also welcoming the budget cut, though she says that this is precisely what they were pushing for during the deliberations at the House. She even adds that it would be the best to give the task force nothing at all or a zero budget. Meanwhile, the vice chairman of the government's anti-communist task force is calling on senators to reconsider the agency's budget cut. In a statement, National Security Advisor Hermogenes Esperon Jr. says that senators should consider the plight of the people in the villages affected by the 53-year insurgency. He adds that aside from prioritizing their COVID-19 response, the government should also have the political will to fight the security threats in the country. We're taking a quick break. Still to come, the Philippines put forward its boldest target, its boldest cuts to the national emission target at the COP26 summit. That story and more up next on The Rundown. Please stay tuned.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods, no? And we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
Back, the Philippines is determined to be a world leader in the fight against climate change. Speaking at the COP26 summit, Finance Secretary Carlos Dominguez reiterated the Philippines' commitment to reducing greenhouse gas emissions by 75% in 2030, which he says is the boldest national goal put forth by any country. To fulfill this ambitious target, Dominguez says a sustainable finance roadmap has been launched to get green projects moving across the archipelago. He also highlights the push for a law banning single-use plastics and Manila's partnership with the Asian Development Bank to accelerate the transition from coal to clean energy. Dominguez says that these concrete actions demonstrate just how a developing and climate-vulnerable country like the Philippines can help to lead the fight to save the planet. The European Union pledges 100 million euros to the UN's Adaptation Fund. The fund offers financing to developing nations vulnerable to the impacts of climate change. The European Commission says the additional contribution from the bloc's budget is by far the biggest pledge made by donors at the UN's climate conference in Glasgow. Adaptation finance is one of the central topics of discussion at COP26, and it is a high priority for the EU.
Today is the day we need to act on adaptation as well. Financing adaptation is critical. We all repeated that mantra endlessly, but the rhetoric, sadly, is not followed by action. We all need to get cracking And we all need to do it now. Because those who need resources for adaptation also need to have predictability and clarity about its delivery. To the parties pushing for more ambition, I say this. You will find the EU on your side. To the parties stopping and stalling progress, I say, what are you waiting for? Science tells us we're out of time.
Six major car manufacturers will commit to phasing out fossil fuel vehicles around the world by 2040 to take part in the global efforts to cut carbon emissions. Britain says automakers Volvo, Ford, General Motors, Mercedes-Benz, BYD, and Jaguar Land Rover are all set to sign a pledge at the climate talks. However, some big car makers, including the world's top two, Toyota and Volkswagen, as well as crucial car markets China, the US, and Germany, are not joining the pledge. Now, this highlights the remaining challenges of going full electric. Sources say while the United States is not signing up, key states like California and New York are on board. The United States is setting a goal of achieving net zero greenhouse gas emissions in the aviation sector by 2050. That's according to the U.S. Transportation Secretary. The White House previously targeted 20% lower aviation emissions by 2030 after airlines faced pressure from the environmental groups to use more sustainable fuel. But according to studies, that isn't enough. New aircraft technologies, along with cutting airport emissions, will be needed in order to reach that goal, in addition to finding and using sustainable fuel. President Joe Biden has previously set a target of making the U.S. net carbon neutral by 2050. The COP26 summit centers on limiting global warming to 1.5 degrees Celsius. This report explains just how significant that number is.
1.5 within reach.
So to keep that 1.5 goal in sight,
a 1.5 degree budget.
Vital 1.5 degrees climate target.
Above 1.5.
World leaders and scientists have stressed that 1.5 degrees Celsius is the magic number when it comes to saving our planet. The 2015 Paris Agreement commits countries to limit the global average temperature rise to below 2 degrees Celsius above pre-industrial levels. But they're aiming for 1.5. So, what difference does 0.5 of a degree actually make? The world has already heated to around 1.1 degrees Celsius above pre-industrial levels. Scientists say crossing the 1.5 degrees Celsius threshold risks unleashing far more severe climate change effects on people, wildlife, and ecosystems. Just this year, torrential rains flooded China and Western Europe. The Pacific Northwest sweltered in record heat, and Greenland saw massive melting events. Climate scientist Daniela Jacob at the Climate Service Centre Germany says, quote, half a degree means much more extreme weather, and it can be more often, more intense, or extended in duration. The difference between 1.5 degrees C and 2 degrees C is also critical for Earth's oceans and frozen regions. Warming of 1.5 degrees would destroy at least 70% of coral reefs. But at 2 degrees, more than 99% would be lost. Take Australia's Great Barrier Reef, for example. A recent study has found that the corals could still have a chance to survive if global warming is kept to 1.5 degrees. Professor Terry Hughes of the Australian Research Council's Centre of Excellence for Coral Reef Studies is the study's lead author.
Trajectory of the Great Barrier Reef will depend critically on how much hotter the planet gets. If we can hold global warming to 1.5 degrees global average warming, then I think we'll still have a vibrant Great Barrier Reef. But if we go to 3-4 degrees of global average warming, which is tragically the trajectory we're currently on, then there won't be much left of the Great Barrier Reef or any other coral reefs throughout the tropics.
Avoiding crossing the 1.5 degree threshold requires almost halving global CO2 emissions by 2030 from 2010 levels and cutting them to net zero by 2050. It's an ambitious task that scientists, financiers, negotiators and activists continue to debate how to achieve and pay for.
We should try and keep 1.5 within reach. And I hope that is the spirit with which negotiators will continue to approach these discussions.
In other news, the White House plans swift action on its $17 billion revamp of U.S. ports. The upgrade is part of U.S. President Joe Biden's $1 trillion infrastructure package, which passed Congress last week. The White House says work will begin within the next 60 days for the construction of at coastal ports and inland waterways. Meanwhile, some $4 billion will be allotted for the repair of outdated infrastructure. Key ports of entry will also be modernized and expanded. The major revamp comes as congestion in U.S. ports continues amid lingering issues in the global supply chain. In other news, Malala Yousafzai, the youngest Nobel Peace Prize laureate, has tied the knot. Here's the full story.
I want every girl and woman to be proud of herself.
Nobel Peace Prize laureate Malala Yousafzai announced on social media Tuesday that she has gotten married. The 24-year-old who lives in Britain said she and her new husband, who she named only as Asser, had wed in the city of Birmingham and celebrated at home with their families. Her post on Twitter read in part, "Today marks a precious day in my life. Asser and I tied the knot to be partners for life." Malala survived being shot at the age of 15 by a Taliban gunman in her native Pakistan in 2012. She is revered in many parts of the world, especially in Western countries, for her personal courage and her eloquence in advocating for the rights of girls and women. She was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize. In Pakistan, her activism has divided public opinion. Malala gave no other information about her husband apart from his first name. Internet users identified him as Asser Malik, general manager of the Pakistan Cricket Board's High School Performance Center. Reuters could not confirm this.
Here at home, the lyric video of this year's ABS-CBN Christmas ID hits 1 million views on YouTube less than 24 hours after its release. As of writing, Andito Tayo Para Sa Isa't Isa ranked 1.7 million views on YouTube and over 6 million views on Facebook. The all-star recording of the song includes Sharon Cuneta, Regine Velasquez, Sarah Geronimo, among others. Celebrity love team Catherine Bernardo and Daniel Padilla, as well as other young personalities, also lent their voices to the song. ABS-CBN says the tune is a loving tribute to everyday heroes who continuously give hope, strength, and inspiration despite all of the challenges. And that was the rundown. I'm Mikey Oreta. We'll be back with more news at 11. Stay safe and keep it here on AMC.